After the storm, after the rain stopped and the water subsided, the animals went back to the mountains, the desert, the ocean. Well, we wanted to talk about it. So we painted it and we danced it and we sang it. And by recreating beauty, we created another kind of beauty. And if they could tell us what we knew, maybe it could tell us what we didn't know, where we come from before life, where we go after life, what's funny, what's sacred. We began to traffic in the alphabet. We bragged about our opposable thumbs, our heightened sense of self. And if we were made in the Creator's image, then we too could create. And if our dreams could surprise and delight us, then maybe we could surprise and delight the Creator. We found ritual, and at times it brought us together. Other times it was subversive, it was visceral, it tore us from the herd. But it always sought to take us to that place before right, before wrong, to that place where I am, therefore I think, to the white hot, the birthplace of the spark. And then it started to rain.
I took the train up from Illinois. I was following through on a letter you sent. I always feared that you'd be true, honey, true to yourself, to the bitter end. It just kinda happened, or so she says. She was drinking and lonely, you know the rest. And he meant nothing, he was happenstance. She says she loves me still and wants a second chance. But I don't wanna be together, I don't wanna be apart. I don't want none of this love for you, honey, deep, deep down in my heart. Where's my golden crown that you took and passed around? There's no telling what a man might do with a life like this when it all falls through. 'Cause I don't wanna be together, I don't wanna be apart. I don't want none of this love for you, honey, deep, deep down in my heart. You were my dream come true. Can't you see what you put me through? The love that tears me apart still beats deep, deep down in my heart. Deep, deep, deep down in my heart.
The first time I went to Seattle was on a bet. I was at a party with a buddy of mine named Easy Bob Danke, and he was telling me you could get good seafood in Minneapolis. And I'm like, no way, Bob, you gotta go to one of the coasts. No, 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 he says, there's a restaurant that flies it in here fresh every day. Okay, I'm thinking Bob doesn't know anything about seafood. I mean, Bob's idea of sushi is a thought in Mrs. Paul's. So that night, we find ourselves screaming out of the St. Paul Freight Yards in a boxcar on our way to Seattle, Washington for a seafood dinner. And Bob takes a 2x4 board and he jams it in the door. I say, what are you doing, Bob? He says, well, these doors have a habit of sliding shut, and if it does, it can be up to 3 weeks before they open them. And he figures a lot of unpleasantness could happen before they found our bodies. So I go into the corner and curl up and fall asleep. And the next day I wake up and we're not moving anymore. So I look out the boxcar door to find we've been uncoupled from the rest of the train. Bob says, don't worry, another train will be along here any minute. 3 days later, a train comes through the freight yard, and Bob says, this guy's not gonna stop. I go, what do you mean, Bob? He says, I know about these trains. This guy's gonna keep going. We gotta catch it. We gotta catch a moving train. Okay, even I know this is stupid, but I grab my backpack and I put it on, and as I run, I can feel the shoulder harnesses cutting into my blades, and I finally catch up to this open boxcar door when all of a sudden I hear Bob say, oh, cardboard. I go, what do you mean, Bob? He says, cardboard, it's like gold on the rails. So we grab this sheet of cardboard and we're running. It's blowing us back like a sail. And we finally get up to the open boxcar. Bob flings the cardboard in, and then he does this beautiful Fosbury flop up and into the boxcar. Okay, now it's my turn. I get my arms up and into the boxcar door, but I can't pull myself up. My pack is too heavy, and my feet are skipping off the rocks and the ties and the rails. Finally, Bob reaches out. He grabs me and the pack and pulls us both up and into the boxcar, where I immediately start to cry. The tears come flooding out. These emotions just pour out. Bob is laughing his head off. He walks over to my pack, opens it up, and pulls out three bricks and says, yeah, while you were asleep, I put these in here. He's laughing so hard he's stumbling like John Wayne in Sands of Iwo Jima. He's saying, yeah, I felt so bad I almost told you. Now, I want to kill Bob, but I don't, because that was a good one. So I start laughing too. It's really that or homicide. Now, we get up to Fargo, North Dakota, and we're going through the Fargo freight yards at about 35 miles an hour. Oh, and this was the day when Fargo had this big billboard outside of town that said, welcome to North Dakota, mountain removal project complete. And we're going through the freight yards when all of a sudden Bob says, uh-oh. I says, what do you mean, uh-oh, Bob? He says, uh-oh. He says, we're heading up to Grand Forks. He says, we don't want to go to Grand Forks. We want to go to Minot. And I'm about to say, well, what are you going to do about it, Bob? When I look and he's throwing my backpack outside the boxcar door, I see my pack flying through the air. It hits. It explodes. I see my things flying through the air, my underwear, my shirts, my martini olives. I look and there's Bob's pack outside the door. I see Bob's pack flying through the air. It hits. It explodes. And I'm kind of looking to see what Bob brought along when there's Bob outside the door. I see Bob flying through the air. I think, oh man, if Bob hits and the same thing happens to Bob is what happened to my pack, I will never jump. So I closed my eyes and I leapt. And there I was, out in the world. I could turn and look back into that dark hole, but now I was out in the colors and I was flying through the air at 35 miles an hour. And I was never gonna land. And then I felt my pants split. And then I felt my knee split, and my head, and my knee, and my head, and my knee, and I started to roll and roll and roll. And it reminded me of when I was little and I used to take my brother to the laundromat and put him in a dryer. And I would think, when is his quarter gonna run out? And then I was thinking, when is my quarter gonna run out? I'm rolling and rolling, and finally I stop, and I get up, and my head hurts, and my knees cut, and I look, and there's Easy Bob putting his stuff back in his pack, so I start putting my stuff back in my pack, and that's when I looked as the train stopped. We finally did make it to Seattle, Washington. Oh, but on the way, we ran into these two guys. They were from Chicago, and they were going to the Rainbow Gathering in Idaho. Okay, the Rainbow Gathering is this counterculture event. It's kind of like a Grateful Dead concert without the Grateful Dead. And they were going to find some righteous herb and mellow wine and a place to live, you know, like maybe a yurt. And I said, what are you guys gonna do for money? And one of them said he'd written some poems to sell in case things got tight. And the next day I wake up and one of these guys is in a fitful rage. I mean, his anger does not match his tie-dyed outfit. And he's screaming his head off. And Bob says, don't worry, I'll handle this. So I go to the other side of the boxcar, waiting for the other guy to sneak in the back. I'll bop him in the head with the 2x4. Bob gets out of the boxcar and squares off against this guy. Okay, Bob's like one of those brothers that you have that you fight with your whole life. But when the world turns on you, there he is by your side. And you know if he does to the world what he's already done to you, the world doesn't have a chance. So Bob and this guy get ready. When all of a sudden Bob says, oh, whoa, no, wait. The guy does wait. Bob walks over to the boxcar, takes out his teeth, and sets them on the boxcar floor. Now, I've played rugby with Bob for years, and in our clubhouse, we have a shelf for guys to put their teeth before going out on the pitch. I've seen those teeth for years. I didn't know they were Bob's. So, Bob turns around, they square off. Now the guy knows two things. One, Bob's probably done this before, and two, Bob's probably better at this than he is. So, he drops to his knees and he starts crying how his buddy had taken off with all the poems and left him there all by himself. Bob says it would be wise if he catches up to his buddy. And the guy says, I don't think things are going to go well. Bob says they're going to go just fine. Are you sure? Yeah, I'm sure. I could tell him stories that would shake his confidence in Bob, but I keep them to myself. The guy goes up and over the hill. I crawl back into the boxcar with Bob. Bob's asleep in 5 minutes, but I stay awake with that 2x4 board because I know there are few things worse than a hippie gone bad. We do get out to Seattle, Washington, and we have our seafood dinner, and it goes great. And Bob gets a job in a tuna canning factory. He's out there canning fish. And he says, you go back by yourself. Don't worry, you can make it. You've been on the rails long enough. You know the secrets of the rails. And you know what? He was right. I did. So I got on a freight train. It was called a hot shot. Now, a hot shot goes about 70 miles an hour. I'm going to be back in Minneapolis in 3 days, no problem. And I'm flying across Montana when all of a sudden we slow down to a crawl. I look outside the boxcar door, and I see the train ahead of us has derailed. Okay, you think you're safe on a boxcar because you're surrounded by gauge steel, and then you see a derailment, and these cars are crushed like pop cans. You know how fragile life really is. And I'm looking at this derailment when all of a sudden his head pops up in the corner, downright corner. He says his name is Ed, and can he get aboard? Boxcar etiquette, I say, of course. So Ed crawls in, and he's only got two teeth in his head, one above the other, but later he tells me he won't have them pulled because I lack my steak. And we go across Montana into North Dakota, and we eat like kings because Ed knows where every Dunkin' Donuts is thrown out in the dumpsters. He knows where every grocery store, and he is the most amazing chef. And one day, we're passing through a freight yard, and all of a sudden, Ed says, well, we're going to have a recession. I say, how do you know, Ed? He goes, look at them cigarette butts. Last time they were smoked down that far, we had a recession. I couldn't even get a puff out of there. Sure enough, 3 months later, I'm back in Minneapolis. It's the early 80s. Boom, we hit a recession. And I'm thinking, oh man, hobo economics. One day I go, Ed, do you ever get lonely on the rails? He said, no, he says he never got lonely. He said he tried to live with a woman in Minneapolis, in a house, but he said we didn't love each other morally, spiritually, and physically, and you need all three or it'll never work. He says, best I ever did was 2 out of 3, so I hopped on the freights where I've been ever since. Where he says, I know how I fit in my world. I made it back to St. Paul, and I got off of that train, and I started to cry, and it wasn't because I was hungry, it wasn't because I was cold, it's because I knew I would never hop freights again. I knew this part of my life was over, and I would try to find someone to love morally, spiritually, and physically, and try to find out how I fit in this world.
Mama give me 20 and say stay out till dawn when the boyfriend was over and they wanted me gone. I would walk through the woods to the old graveyard and roll my own tops and think two kind of thoughts. Are we high enough to clear these trees? I don't know. That was the summer Dave's girlfriend OD. She died in the bathroom at a party down the street. I went to see him the next night. He had a new tattoo. He was watching home movies of her. His face was wet. He looked so confused. They had a funeral for her. The preacher said she was with the Lord. There were lots of pictures of her taped to a poster board. Are we high enough to clear these trees? I don't know. Are we high enough to clear this place? I don't know. Grocery stores in the middle of the night shine their own kind of light. High school halls and shopping malls never fit me right. But my heart would swing free like a lasso from my hand when I'd hear that sound and put the pedal down. I wound up that fall in a hospital on the suicide wing with a lot of people thinking one thing. They had a sign on the wall. It said, no touching at all. There were screams in the dark, nurses running down the hall. On the night that I got there, they showered me and searched me hard. Then they took me to my little room, overlooking the graveyard. When I opened my eyes, I was strapped to the bed. There was a needle in my arm, and part of me was gone. Then they took us outside in our slippers and gowns to play basketball on the blacktop. The ball just bounced till it stopped. Are we high enough to clear these trees? I don't know. Are we high enough to clear this place? I don't know. Grocery stores in the middle of the night shine their own kind of light. High school halls and shopping malls never did me right. But my heart would swing free like a lasso from my hand when I'd hear that sound and put the pedal down. When the leaves were wet behind the old duplex, we used to run at night, naked through the trees. You would lean back against me, and I would try to stay soft. We'd listen to the engines as the planes took off.
My earliest memory places me on my dad's knee, and he's pointing up to the stars, and he goes, "You see that star, Kevin?" I reach out my tiny hand. He goes, "You want to touch it?" He goes, "No, let's leave that star there, Kevin. With that star there, you can go anywhere in the world. That star can take you to places never seen by another. But more importantly, that star can bring you home again." Oh, had my infant tongue been more explicit, I could have explained to him, "No, Father, the universe isn't a machine, it's a creator. And I don't want to use that star as a vector. No, I want to go there. Because if I can get to that star, it's a short hop to the next, to the next, to the next. And in no time, I'm hunting with Orion. I'm cartwheeling with Cassiopeia. I'm racing the gods, drinking their wine, eating their meat. No, Father, get me to that star, and I'm never coming home."
It's who you are now, who you wanna be now, or are you someone you don't wanna be? It's what you wanted, really what you wanted, or is it nothing like you dreamed? Mama, there's a hole in the life we've made. Thousands of people laughing in the shade, pointing their fingers at the mess we've made. There's a tourist in every heart that just wants to stay. But winter's coming and it's time to go. It's already over, we just didn't know. They're stacking up wood where the flowers grow. There's a tourist in every heart that can't wait to go. It's who you are now, who you wanna be now, or are you someone you don't wanna be? It's what you wanted, really what you wanted, or is it nothing like your dream? Honey, there's a boat and it waits for us. Somewhere there's a time and a place for us. It could be perfect if it wasn't for us. 'Cause mama, we're in love with a memory, a perfect dream of how it used to be, when our hair was windy and our nights were free. That tourist in every heart sees what it wants to see. It's who you are now, who you wanna be now, or are you someone you don't wanna be? It's what you wanted, really what you wanted, or is it nothing like your dream?
I don't know if you know this about Americans, but we have a genetic anomaly that's found more here than anywhere else on the planet. It's called the long gene, and it's a genetic marker that's found in people that have broken away from society. Explorers tend to have it, and adventurers, the whatever happened to's in their high school reunions whose last words were, "Watch this," or "What's this do?" Now, my dad was definitely a member of the Long Gene Club. He always had these little experimental aircrafts, and I'd be at college, sit next to a guy in psychology class, and all of a sudden we would hear a plane buzzing the campus, prop back, flaps up, me, and I would turn to the kid next to me, I'd go, "My dad's here, my dad's here." And I'd run to the airport, which was a mile from campus, and sure enough, their dad would be with the prop still going around, and I'd hop up on the wing, I'd get in the plane, pull the cowling over, and then Dad and I would fly down the Minnesota River Valley, the leaves changing in the fall. I remember one time, Dad and I are flying down the river valley when all of a sudden we hit a fog bank. I mean, you couldn't see anything. And I look over at my dad, and like usual, he's shelling peanuts, drinking hot coffee, unfolding a map, and tapping an instrument. And he turns to me and he says, "Hey, Kev, do me a favor. Look out that window and see if you can spot the ground." So I'm looking out the window and I hear my dad say, "Hey, Kev, it might not be down." Now, my dad was a person of the sky, but he came from people of the earth. My grandparents were farmers, and I loved visiting their farm. We had what was called unstructured time. Now they call it boredom, but I was never bored, and I've never been bored to this day, okay? I've been to some plays where I wished I was somewhere else, and somewhere I would have fallen asleep if I hadn't been the one talking, but I've still never been bored, and I've got my grandma to thank. Her name was Grace, and she was my dad's mom. And whereas the other grandma was ample and smelled like cookie dough, this one was frail and thin and smelled like frail and thin. And she had these huge earlobes from wearing clip-on earrings her whole life, these giant earlobes that scared me in a National Geographic kind of way. And there was always a sense of fear surrounding this grandma. But once a week, Grandma Grace would pile us into the car and we would drive to Brookfield, Missouri, population 5,000, and we would park at angled parking, and then Grandma would keep a running commentary of the action of the town all afternoon. Oh, and she loved to park in front of the drugstore, because you can tell a lot about somebody by what they bring out of a drugstore. And one time we're parked there, and this woman comes across the front of the car, and as she passed the radiator, suddenly her drawers fell from underneath her dress and landed on the sidewalk. This woman, without missing a beat, she takes her foot and kicks them in the air. They did a flip in the air and landed right in her purse. Without missing a step, my grandma said, "I would have left them." Then she points to a yellow car. "Whose yellow car is that, Kevin? Whose car is that?" I go, "I don't know, Grandma." She says, "I've got to know whose car that is. I guess when you live in a small town and you don't know who somebody's car is, it's cause for concern." She says, "Oh, that restaurant closed. I knew they would. They opened on the day of a funeral. Kevin, never open a restaurant on the day of a funeral." "Okay, Grandma." All of a sudden, she sees one of her friends. She rolls down the window. "Oh, hello, Charlene. Hello, Grace. What brings you to town?" "Oh, it's my hair day." "Well, isn't that nice?" "Hey, Grace, whose yellow car is that?" "I don't know. I don't know either." "All right, Charlene. All right, Grace." She's gone. Grandma says, "Don't look." I look. She says, "That woman, she spit." Sure enough, this woman spit. Now, I consider myself a champion spitter, known on the playground for accuracy and distance, but this woman's spit seemed to do her bidding in midair. It went around a fire hydrant and hit a cup. I look up. She's staring right at me. I hear my grandma say, "Kevin, never fall for a woman who spits." But I'm thinking, "Grandma, you are so too late on this one." Now, my grandma had a rule. No dogs in the house. We said, "Grandma, it's a wiener dog. It's going to die outside." She said, "Okay. One accident, though, and that is it." And it would have been, too. For some strange reason, that dog stayed right next to my grandma. I thought it was like those fish on Mutual of Omaha's Wild Kingdom that stay near the sharks for self-preservation. But one day, I'm going past the kitchen, and I saw my grandma sneaking that dog a piece of turkey. So I told my brother, he goes, yeah. He saw grandma sneaking the dog food under the dinner table. And one by one, every member of my family said they saw my grandma sneaking that dog food. My grandma gave out her love like that turkey, a little bit at a time, and you had to look fast or you'd miss it. But it was always there, never flagging and never in doubt. I know she didn't want to live in that farm. She wanted to live in town and go to that stinky beauty parlor every day. But once a year, it was usually at Thanksgiving, we would all go into the parlor and my grandma would sit down at the piano and play songs from the 20s and 30s, her high voice cracking. And even as the years progressed and her arthritis worsened, Grandma would sit at that piano, play through the pain, that piano sounding horribly out of tune, until my grandma sang, and then it all made sense. From my grandma, I learned there's beauty in the mundane and to always, always play through the pain. To me, she truly was Grace.
Way down below the Mason-Dixon line, down where the honeysuckle are entwined, down where the southern winds are blowing, there's where the daisy's growing. The girls up north in the gay finery, twirling around in society, singing songs of Dixie darling, where I long to be. My Dixie darling, listen to this song I sing, beneath the silver moon, with the banjo riding tune. My heart is ever true, I love no one but you, my Dixie darling, my Dixie queen. I'm going down south to have a good time, see my friends in old Caroline, drink my booze and do as I please, all them girls I long to squeeze. Singing songs of Dixie darling, there's where I long to be going, down where the jelly roll's flowing, with my Dixie queen. My Dixie darling, listen to this song I sing, beneath a silver moon with a banjo riding tune. My heart is ever true. I love no one but you, my Dixie darling, my Dixie queen. That's a song from my grandma's time.
Now, I've been privy to grandma stories because after I told that, Mason kicked into some of his own. You got to tell these guys about your grandma.
My grandma's hilarious. She was serious. She was not messing around at all. So, I don't know. I mean, like, the good example is I was 15 years old and I decided to get my ear pierced. And I thought it was just, I didn't think anything of it. And I was at my grandma's house and I opened the fridge and I was looking in the fridge for stuff and to eat. And then suddenly my grandma's like right here. And she's looking up at me and she's just getting dark. And I was like afraid to look at her. And she's like, you look like a hooker. I don't know, I must have looked a little like a hooker.
How does grandma know?
She knows, she'd have the, you know, she'd always call me a dumb guac. You dumb guac. I'm like, what's that from? That doesn't make any sense. But she'd dig deep for it, you know, and she was funny. We had this room in our house growing up where, I don't know why we had this room, but in the front of our house where there's a big picture window, my parents didn't buy any furniture for that room. So it's just an empty room where you drive by the house, this is the empty room. And I think they said like, well, you know, we get the rest of the stuff in. It's a bigger house than our last house. We'll get that last. We want to get some good stuff for it. But, you know, it never got filled ever. So it's like years of this empty room that my brother and I decided was, a good place to tape a soccer goal on the wall. So we had this, like, big tape soccer goal. And I remember one day I was running around the corner kicking the ball. And I kicked as hard as I could. And I caught the corner of the wall with my foot. And my little toe just went kink and snapped totally sideways. And my grandma from the other room goes, ah, something's broken. She had that kind of radar. She'd seen it before, I think, you know. But that room's funny. That room, it just reminded me of how everybody's family has something that just seems totally normal to them growing up. And then you look back, I was like, that room was totally empty, you know? It never had stuff in it. And it was the front room of the house. And lots of people came through that, you know? And it reminded me of my, I had one friend who had four brothers and sisters, and it was just chaos at his house all the time. And I was walking up the stairs to his room one day, and it was the front half of the hall, and all the way up was like sort of like one color. And then right in the middle of the hall, there's just the final stroke. And then the rest of the hall was another color. I was like, what's going on with this hall? And he's like, well, never asked. My dad was just painting, and then just one last stroke, and just that was 5 years ago.
When we moved up to Minnesota, my dad would never paint our house. Like, paint was shipping out the side. And the neighbors kept calling, you got to paint the house. And my dad had a phrase, it's a rental, boys, never work on a rental. So finally, the neighbors, you got to paint the house. So dad goes, okay, we're going to paint the house. He goes, but we're going to do it in one day. So he gives my brother a wire brush. He goes, knock off the loose dirt and paint to my brother. And he goes, me. He says, Kevin, take up tape and window and tape up the windows. Then my dad went and rented a compressor and air sprayer, and he's just going to spray it on the house. And he goes, well, here's the invoice going back tonight, boys. So he said, okay, we go, what color are we going to paint it, Dad? And he goes, I don't know. And my dad was a manufacturer's representative, and he sold paints and pipes around the state of Minnesota. And he'd sold some paint to a water tower in northern Minnesota, and they'd had extra, so they chipped it back. And Dad didn't remember what color that water tower was, but that's the color our house was going to be. So we go out to the garage. He pops open a 5-gallon pail. He goes, ew, well, boys, looks like we're painting her black.
Did he do it?
Yeah, we're still one day, you know, and my brother knocked off the paint, and then my dad, I taped up the windows, Dad got the paint on, we were done by noon.
Wow.
We got done by noon, and Dad says, we got that compressor another half a day, what do you say we do the trim? Okay, Dad, what color? Don't know. So he pops open another can, he goes, well, it looks like it's going to be orange. So we did all the trim in orange, and before we were even done, the neighbors are going, that's primer, right? That's primer, you're painting over that, right? No, that's the color we painted the house. That's the color that house is to this day, because the paint we used was a special graffiti-proof paint they use on water towers for when junior high kids climb up and write their names. As soon as it rains, the rain will just wash their names off. So the next people to buy that house and paint it, which I know they will, as soon as it rains,
dads and paints.
Dads and paints.
My dad, one time my dad said, you know, this is such a hassle getting a Christmas tree every year. Let's just paint a Christmas tree on the wall, you know? And we all were just like, well, that could be pretty sweet, you know? And he's like, and you know, while we're at it, let's just paint a fireplace beside it. So, and then he's like, go get the nails, you know? So we just nailed 100 nails in all over the tree and hung the ornaments on the front of the tree, which was actually very surreal and semi-depressing, because you sit in the room and it's just, Christmas is just so far away, you know? And it's just a line of presents coming out to you in front of you, and which should be exciting, but it's just intense. It's pretty intense. But I remember that year specifically because it was like the tree on the wall, distant Christmas, and then just a long line of, but there's one present that was a giant box that turned out to be one of those table hockey games that with the rods, you know, where you have like the little hockey players that can move, and the sweetest present ever for me. My brother and I played that. So that room, the empty room, became like the hockey room, and that was all day, every day for that whole, you know, break of Christmas break. We played that hockey game, and I wrote a song about it, actually, and this is a song called Table Hockey. Do you want to play table hockey with me on this Sunday afternoon when there's nothing better to do? You be the Capitals, I'll be the Flames. Do you want to play table hockey with me in this rectangle of the sun? We'll pretend that it's just for fun. Still, we know all the players by names. We'll spend hours and hours and hours and hours just glued. Hours and hours, such wonderful hours with you, with you. Do you want to play Super Mario with me on this TV with no sound, sitting right there on the ground in the corner of the living room? Do you want to play Super Mario with me? Yes, I'll wait till you get home. I won't play the seventh level alone, but you better get home soon. We'll spend hours and hours and hours and hours just glued. Hours and hours, such wonderful hours with you, with you. Do you want to play table hockey with me in this faded memory full of little hearts and hands and cassettes of heavy metal bands? Do you want to play Super Mario Wii in these open days to come where we'll lose and we'll win some? I'm so grateful to have the chance to spend hours and hours and hours and hours just glued. Hours and hours, such wonderful hours with you. Hours and hours and hours and hours just glued. Time stops for no one. I'm lost in the moment with you, with you.
Well, long before there was Jackass the movie, there was me and my brother. And we were always going to the emergency room for something done in the name of science. And I remember one time we pulled up and it was my turn to get stitched up. And Mom and I were running to the emergency room. We just heard this honking horn and we turned and there was a van with a side door open and a woman having a baby right there in the parking lot. That's as far as she made it. She had a doctor and a nurse attending her. But what had drawn our attention to this van was this honking horn. And we looked, and in the front seat were two boys, one honking the horn as fast as he could and the other dumping the contents of the glove compartment out the passenger side window. And in between pushes, the mom is yelling, "Riley, knock it off!" And I remember looking at my mom, and she's staring at that van with her mouth hanging open, and I'm like, "See, Mom, you got normal sons." But my brother and I, when we were together, I mean, we were greater than the sum of our parts. It was like, one time I was watching Laurel and Hardy, and they were hired to move a piano, and they came to this guy's house, and when the guy saw him, he said, "Wait a minute, I only hired one worker." And without batting an eye, Stan said, we can do the work of one. And that's like me and my brother. That was like us. We could do the work of one. Together of us, we made one solid unit. I mean, my brother, we couldn't be more different. When it came to Halloween, we picked completely different costumes. My brother always picked a costume to put fear into the hearts of others. And I always picked something I feared because I felt by crawling into its skin, I could understand it and therefore no longer fear it. One year, we both went as Richard Nixon. But my brother has perfect eyesight. You can tell by these glasses. I can barely see the big E in the doctor's office. He stands straight and tall. My knees look like I'm smuggling walnuts. I mean, my body, it was always something about my body. But in my head, I got a little extra skull in my head. I learned this. I was playing a game over Halloween when I was a kid called Who Could Break the Most Pumpkins with Their Head, which was kind of the rules, too. And I hit a pumpkin, and it was way better at the game than I was, and I was knocked out, and they said, you better get your head checked. You might have a concussion. So I went in, and they x-rayed my head, and our doctor, Dr. Braun, this German guy, was in his office, and I could see him staring at my x-ray from the waiting room. So I go, Dr. Braun, is everything okay? And he turned to me, and he goes, you have the head of an ape. I go, what? And he told me I've got this protruding brow line. I've got some skull that goes back to where a little brain ought to be. And I said, well, Dr. Braun, don't you ever see heads like this? And he says, not for thousands of years. So I got my head. The one thing my brother and I, we did have in common was we loved cop shows. In the 70s cop shows, oh man, they had the best shows. They had Hawaii Five-O, and they had Dukes of Hazzard and Rockford Files, by the way, could spin around his car, and anything by Quinn Martin. Quinn Martin Productions, oh man, Police Woman with that hot Angie Dickinson, Mannix, oh man. Mannix, we loved him because whenever he arrested somebody, he pulled right up in front of their house. I mean, he never had to look for parking. So whenever we got good parking, we'd call it Mannix parking. But the best of all was Kojak. Oh man, with his pinstripe suits and his beautiful paisley ties, it almost hurt to look at the TV. And so for fashion's sake, we went out and got our Kojak outfits. I remember we got these shirts, we called them ooh shirts. They were polyesters with long collars. And I remember when you touched them, you went ooh. And I got these bell-bottoms like my brother's, but my brother's bell-bottoms fit him, but mine didn't. I was too small, so my mom sewed them together in the back, and when I looked, instead of two pockets, I had one pocket right in the middle of the back. And I put my wallet in there, and it wasn't altogether uncomfortable. And the other thing that my brother and I shared, we shared a car. We had a 67 Chevelle, and my dad helped us pick it out because it was underpowered. It was a huge car. He thought this was safe. What we saw was potential. We put a 327 engine in it. We put in Holley carbs. We had headers sticking out the sides. I mean, jacked up past your ascot. This car, I mean, it was cherry. So much Bondo, a magnet wouldn't stick anywhere. That car, that thing could have made it through the airport. And then we cherried out the inside. We had a chain link wheel that you could spin. We had bare feet made out of metal that was an accelerator and a gas and a brake. And then in the back, we had fun fur that went from orange to yellow with one blast of sunlight. And underneath it was these crackle speakers. Every song sounded like it featured a kazoo. And baby moons on the side, man. And then we painted it purple. And this color purple only found in the discount bin at Kmart. And my brother screwed a bowling trophy on the front, and we were set. We called it the P-Rex, for Purple Rex. Because of the dinosaur, it burnt every mile we went down the road. And I tell you, this thing was so cherried out, we couldn't wait. We were gonna debut it at homecoming, and I could not wait. So homecoming was a week away, but something happened that changed everything. Okay, now to graduate from Osseo, you had to be beat up by a kid named Brian McLean. And it's like you had to check it off or they wouldn't give you your diploma. And This Friday was my brother's turn to be beat up by Brian McLean, and the whole school turned out. We couldn't wait to see this. Even Brian was amazed by the amount of people that came to watch this fight, and I was thinking of who I was gonna cheer for when all of a sudden I heard this honking horn, and we turn, and there's my brother in the parking lot standing next to a 55-gallon barrel of tractor oil from one of his buddies, and he kicks it over, and he gets in the P-Rex, and he starts spinning. He wasn't going to waste a crowd getting beat up. He started spinning until this huge black-blue smoke started forming, and Jerry, the cop, finally arrived, and when Jerry saw something he couldn't handle, his hands just went over his head, and consonants left him. Vowels just poured out. And my brother kept spinning, and when the smoke cleared, he was gone. Jerry regained his senses and followed my brother, and I thought, if my brother can just get to the gravel pits, he'll be fine. We knew the gravel pits. We played there our whole lives. Sure enough, when I got home, there's my brother sitting in front of the TV eating Fruit Loops, and I said, Steve, what did you do, man? I was going to debut the P-Rex at homecoming. He said, don't worry. It'll all be blown over by then. So a week goes by, and it's homecoming. I can't wait. That night, we're going to take the P-Rex and show everybody our car. But my dad comes home and says, oh, good, you got the car running again. Now you can get that junk out of the garage. Oh, man, we forgot. So he said, don't worry, you'll be able to make it to homecoming in time. So we hooked up our trailer, this white U-Haul that we had that had two wheels on one side, one wheel on the other, and we just had painted it white. We hooked it up, and it was at such an angle being on the jacked-up P-Rex, but we threw everything in the back, all this garbage. There was paint cans and glass. There was old carpet, film canisters with grassy knoll written on it, some kind of artist Picasso or something. We just threw all this garbage in there and filled this thing up to the brim. And then we said, okay, the dump's only 2 miles away. We got it made. So we're on our way to the dump, and we hit a stop sign. And when you hit the stop sign, this is exactly what went through my mind. That trailer passing us looks just like our trailer. No car on the front, and it was. And our trailer went through the intersection and into a guy's yard. I could see the guy in his living room watching TV, and I think, this guy's a dead man. Here comes our garbage in a trailer right for him. Luckily, the tongue hit a retaining wall and threw our garbage all over this guy's lawn. So he comes out, and he's totally irate, and he's furious. My brother and I said, we'll clean it up. We'll get it all cleaned up. He says, all will be forgiven if you get everything cleaned up. And he had some garbage on the side of his house, a rug, and some paint cans. If we threw those in the back, it'd be fine. So we got it all cleaned up. And I remember it took us 2 hours, and we were still going to make it to homecoming. Right as I'm raking up the last little bit, my dad drives by. And I'll never forget that look on his face, his two boys raking a stranger's yard. But much to his credit, my dad never said anything. We got done, and my brother said, we still have time. We can still make homecoming. So we got in the P-Rex, and we drove to homecoming. Luckily, we were playing the Trojans, and their school colors were purple and white. So we looked like we were part of the band, that we had equipment. So we pulled right up front, and my brother says, hey, Mannix Parking, right up into the front. I could see our band up ahead, our big drum major, Mike Marichek, 6'5", and we had these big beef eater hats, and he was all in white. He looked like a giant Q-tip. And I turn, and there's my brother. I don't know where it came from, but in his hand was an egg, perfect egg. And he rolls down the window, and he goes, watch this, and he let it fly right into the whole group of Trojan band members. And I looked, and we both saw it at the same time. Turning, probably in the middle of that, to get in a fight was Brian McLean. And that aerodynamic ovum headed right for his shiny forehead. And my brother didn't even pause, didn't even look to see it hit. He punched the gas, and we were out of there, going down the freeway as fast as the P-Rex could go, pulling that heavy trailer. And he says, I can't get going any faster. He's gaining. Sure enough, in the rear mirror, you could see this car getting. He says, Brian, it's Brian McLean. I'm a dead man. I said, hit it, Steve. He says, I'm trying. He said, that does it. I'm just pulling over. I'm getting it over with. He pulled it over. He says, at least nobody will see this happen. And he pulled over, and we got out of the car. And even as we're walking back, I can hear playing Paranoid from Black Sabbath on our 8-track. And I'm headed back, and all of a sudden, Brian McLean doesn't get out of that other car. No, three girls got out. And my brother goes, hey, girls, with crowbars. we didn't even stop. We turned around, we got back into our car. We knew what could happen with girls. We each had a sister, the same sister, and we knew they don't stop. A guy will pommel you and figure you've learned your lesson, but girls do not stop. They keep going. They will beat you past your expiration date into your past lives. They will stomp on your DNA like escaping ants. And I've seen my brother terrified before, but never like this. Hands at 10 o'clock, 2 o'clock, flying down the road. He says, the gravel pits, I've got to make it to the gravel pits. I could see the gas gauge on EA. I said, Steve, I don't think we're going to make it. He says, we've got to make it. And he pulled off onto the gravel pits. What I hadn't seen was, as he passed the trailer, he'd flipped the back door open. So when we hit the washboard of that gravel road, stuff started to fall out of the back of the trailer. A radiator, a rug, some paint cans. And as it did, it lightened the load. The P-Rex started to fire its throat, and I could feel my face going back near my ears. All of a sudden, I heard a boom. I said, Steve, it's a sonic boom. He said, no, the dresser fell out the back. Sure enough, the last thing had fallen out of the back, and now we were blasting past our headlights, and then there he was, up ahead, Jerry, waving his arm with vowels coming out of his mouth. He must have seen us leave the parking lot, knew we were headed for the gravel pits. I said, Steve, hit the brakes. He said, I can't, it's too late. So he put us into a Rockford spin with a trailer, and in front of the bowling trophy, I could see Jerry, and then a cow in a field, and then the girls, and then a ditch, and then Jerry, cow and field, girls, ditch, Jerry, cow and field, girls. And we go blowing by him as my brother punches down on that metal foot, and the girls go into the waiting, waving arms of Jerry as we screamed home. My brother flew into the garage. I grabbed the trailer, ran it out behind, and walked inside where my brother's already eating Fruit Loops in front of the TV. I go upstairs, and I put on my ooh shirt and my pants with the pocket in the back. And I come back down, and my brother says, where are you going? I said, I'm going back to homecoming. I got a good feeling there's a story going around. He says, do you realize we were just in every Quinn Martin production in under an hour? I said, yeah, I do. He says, how are you getting to homecoming? I said, well, I thought I'd ride my bike. He pulled out the keys to the P-Rex and said, why don't I give you a ride?
Hours and hours and hours and hours just flew. Time stops for no one. I'm lost in the moment with you, with you. I'm open, I've been waiting, don't be shy. Wrap your loving arms around me, press your face against mine. Once a liar, once a cheater, yes, your light went underground. I have seen it here inside me, and that light is what was found. Come home, come home, sweetheart. Come home, bitter heart. Let go and love. Are you broken? Are you beaten? Are you stranded in your head? Has your path made you a stranger? Does that stranger want you dead? Come home. Come home, sweetheart. Bitter heart, let go in love. Mm-hmm. Our world is filled with ordinary things, fear and hate and doubt. Our world is filled with only what we see. Can we see love now? Can we see love now?
Places that give each of us solace, whether it's an ocean, a mountain, or a desert, a landscape that speaks somewhere deep within us. For me, it's the shoreline of a lake in Minnesota. My blood pressure drops, I become aware of the lapping water, a bee flying around my head, the sun on my face. Not far from here, some of the first people on this land believed was a sacred site where two rivers come together, its two spirits joining as one. The name Minnesota translates from the Dakota to sky-tinted waters, the place between earth and sky, one and the other, a place of reflection. The Greeks called it an oneric space, a place where dreams live. Now, I grew up on a small lake, and we fished for bullheads in the summer, swam off the end of the dock, and played King of the Mountain on the raft. We'd go up north to the boundary waters and load up the station wagon with supplies, a canoe on the roof, and park overnight in front of a bait store that had a sign out front that said, "Our minnows are guaranteed to catch fish or die trying." There are frogs and turtles, birds and muskrats and minks, the call of the loon. There's an Ojibwe poem that goes, "They keen as parents do when they lose a child, cry as one who's lost a mate. They wail in fear lest they lose each other. They call each other, stay near, you're all I have." I'm reminded of a short time we have on this plane, and that these lakes had names long before we knew them. I still like to go fishing. I used to call it sitting around practicing for when I got old, and now I call it sitting around. The lake is still where I bring my big questions, and I cast them out like fishing. It's not always about catching something. I'm sitting on the lake at sunset. It's reflecting the reds and the yellows. A loon calls, and a mist comes rolling across the mirrored surface where the sky meets the water. And my thoughts dive deep through that reflection, through the layers of cold, into the murky waters, to the unseen, to the treasures, to the solace of the deep.
So you're not from Minnesota though, right?
No, originally from Missouri.
Yeah. Me either. I'm from Pittsburgh, so. But it's a funny thing that I never felt at home in Pittsburgh. I was, you know, distinctly saying to my mom, just like, I just feel like I'm nowhere. I'm nowhere, and I can't get that feeling to go away, especially Sunday evenings. That was the worst, you know, like, I am nowhere out here in the middle of nowhere. And then the thing that I would always do is I'd turn on some music, and I put my headphones on, some Billie Holiday, some AC/DC, some Striper, whatever I was listening to at the time, you know, And I felt somewhere instantaneously. It was like the power of music to just transport me right to the center of somewhere. And I couldn't believe it. It was like a miracle. And I just kept listening to music and then eventually started playing more music. And just, I think it was really going after that feeling of just, you know, get me out of nowhere, bring me to somewhere. And And eventually music brought me up here for the first time. I came to visit my dad. I used to get tapes sent to me by his friend in Minneapolis with Replacements and Prince and Jayhawks. And I was like, where is this place? It was like Narnia. It was like a mythical place that a potpourri of just, you know, awesome stuff. And I came up here the first time, and I remember just even landing on the plane, walking out the first time, and I saw the sky, and there was like that lavender, you know, there's a color of lavender under everything, you know, under the trees, and I don't know what that is. It's just specific to this place, and I felt it at home immediately. I felt at home with the sky. I love the contrast of things here. The, you know, you have the art scene that's so fantastic right up against the wilderness, you know, it's just this contrast. You get the freezing cold, the super hot summers, and I like that. I like my art to have contrast. I like everything to have those severe, you know, polarities, funny and then scary and then all that stuff. It's Minneapolis,
yeah.
You know.
And St. Paul, yeah.
And St. Paul. Can't forget St. Paul. But I always think of Lake Street. You know, that was the first thing. I was like, oh, this place, Lake Street, you know, like, what a spot. And have it anywhere like that in Pittsburgh.
No, we used to, I grew up near Lake, or first place I lived out of college was on Lake Street. There was a place called Barbie's Sauna. We used to say that for $20 you could get anything there except for Barbie or a sauna.
You know, my Lake Street story, one day we were walking, my wife and I were walking down the street, you know, heading towards Lake Street, and this guy was coming towards us, and he was carrying something, and he just beckoned to us, like, oh, can you guys help me? Can you please help me? And I was like, yeah, totally, sure, what's up? And then he starts to point to this thing he has. He goes, you gotta help me with this. And I look, and my wife is like nowhere near me. All of a sudden, she's across the street, and I was like, why is she across the street? And he goes, what is this? And I looked real close, and I'm like, that's a smashed squirrel. And he goes, and I just got, and I was with my wife across the street, and he goes, it's okay, I found it on Lake Street. I knew I was home. And I got a place right by there, right where the Bryant Lake Bowl is over there, and right across the street, or sort of, you know, by there, but now there's condominiums and things. But it was an old gray house, and it was a place where I could set up recording gear in the living room, and I made my first CD there, and this is the first song on my first CD that I made in Minneapolis. Make yourself at home, cause I'm going out across the street to get us some water, cause this water's brown, and I'm so embarrassed to have you here, but I want you around. Usually I'd sing or play my guitar, but I know it won't get very far with you, cause you like music that makes you move, and mine has a groove, but it's nothing I can prove. Please know what I mean when I say nothing. When I say nothing, when I say nothing, when I say things that I buy and things that I think haven't made this a better place to be. Drugs that I try and drinks that I drink haven't made this a better place to be. It's still just a room with the drums in the middle, a couch along the wall that works as my bed. I still have a phone that rings all day. I still have things I wish I would have said. Please know what I mean when I say nothing. When I say nothing. When I say nothing. When I say this whole thing's been hard on me. It breaks my heart to know what that means. And my new place seems strange to me. It breaks my heart. Do you know what that means? It means nothing. So make yourself at home. I'm going out across the street to get us some water, cause this water's brown, and I'm so embarrassed to have you here, but I want you around. Usually I'd sing or play my guitar, but I know it won't get very far with you, cause you like music that makes you move, and mine has a groove, but there's nothing I can prove. Please know what I mean when I say nothing. When I say nothing. When I say nothing. When I say this whole thing's been hard on me. It breaks my heart to know what that means. My new place seems strange to me. It breaks my heart. Do you know what that means? It means nothing.
Yeah, my family did. We came up from Missouri. I remember, you got me thinking about it. When we first got up here, we moved in January. I was like, what is this place? And I remember, well, you got to go to the St. Paul Winter Carnival. Oh, God, okay. And my mom thought we were going to freeze our lungs. She thought we were, like, our lungs would freeze solid. So she gave us these little handkerchiefs we held over our mouths, and the wind blew them right away, and we're out there, oh, we're gonna die, our lungs are gonna freeze. And there's a guy right next to us only wearing a windbreaker, and he goes, didn't we luck out on the weather this year? And but there's a Hmong saying that if you bring a plant from another place, bring some of the dirt from home. So when you transplant it, it will have that dirt from home. It's like bring your gods and your angels can find you. I know when we moved here, my dad brought his sayings. Now, my dad passed away in 85, and now I'm the age that I remember him best. And so when I look in the mirror, I keep wondering if I'm going to see him looking back at me. But I don't look like my dad. But every once in a while, one of these strange sayings will spring from my lips. I mean, he had these weird sayings from Missouri, like it's colder than old Billy Ned, or it's hotter than a $3 pistol. Or one time he says, Kevin, you're about as funny as a hole in the fence. Or when he got off my brother's 10-speed bicycle, he says, yo, girl, that seat's like a cheap hotel. I mean, what? Cheap hotel, $3 pistol. Okay, some of these came from his farming background, like, you're so educated, you're stupid. And, and when I couldn't get my go-kart to work, he said, the loose nut is usually the one on the seat. I said, Dad, it worked fine yesterday. That's what the farmer said about his dead mule. The Sloan's dad used to mix and match his sayings, like, it ain't rocket surgery for crying outside. Or, I don't know whether to brush my butt or wipe my teeth. Now, I remember one time, Dad's sayings got put to the test. Okay, we were going to swimming lessons, and my sister and her friend were in the front seat. My brother and I were in the back seat. And my dad said something was tight. I think it was a jar lid. And he goes, yeah, that jar lid was tighter than... And then he stopped. Now, my brother and I couldn't wait to hear what his tighter than analogy was, because we'd heard many of them and knew none of them were appropriate for this present company. Finally, he stammered out, tighter than the bark on a tree. Oh, God. My brother and I laughed our heads off, but we had to give him credit for the cobbled saying. Now, sometimes I don't know if I'm even getting Dad's sayings right. My friend Misha said a little while back, he was telling his 9-year-old son a joke. He said, a 3-legged dog walks into a bar and says, I'm looking for the man who shot my paw. So the next day he overhears his son telling one of his little friends, a 3-legged dog walks into the bar and says, I'm looking for the man who shot my dad. Both boys are laughing their heads off. The other, you can tell Mason's got sons. The other day, my brother and I were getting a dock out of the lake, and there was a bolt that was tight, and we couldn't get it off, and all of a sudden my brother says, that bolt is tighter than the bark on a tree, and we started to laugh our heads off, and there's my nephew standing right there soaking it in, and I'm thinking, perfect, that phrase will live another generation. So now I know some things about the sayings my dad used to say. Like, I know a $3 pistol's hot because it's probably stolen, and a cheap hotel has no ballroom. But some of the phrases I still don't know what they mean. But like Mr. Sloan would say, if you can't stand the heat, get off the pot. Now, my dad My dad used to tell us everything in the car. Facts of life in a 67 Mustang. I mean, it was great. All these things he would tell us, or sometimes he would turn and just blurt something out like, Kev, the day you own a pair of wingtip shoes is the day I stop worrying about you. Or, Kev, don't get killed just because you know how. One time he turns to me and says, Kev, if you ever get the chance, be an astronaut. Okay, now I knew where this came from. My dad grew up on a farm, and he couldn't wait to get off of that farm. As soon as he was old enough, he learned to fly airplanes, Piper Cubs. And when World War II came, he quickly enlisted in the Navy because they were the last branch still accepting pilots. But my dad made the mistake of, on his form, writing he could type 60 words a minute. And they needed guys who could type way more than they needed pilots. So my dad spent the duration of the war behind the controls of a Smith Corona. Him and another guy in St. Louis processed guys coming back from Europe. And as my dad said, they processed all the guys coming back from Europe. Then my dad processed him. The other guy processed my dad. They locked the door, and the war was over. My dad turned to me in Impala one time and said, Kev, don't learn anything you don't want to be saddled to for the rest of your life. One day he turns to me and he says, Kev, I'm going to Europe. I go, what, Dad? He says, yeah, I've always wanted to go and I'm not getting any younger. Now, this surprised me because I knew my dad liked to travel, but I thought it was just for traveling's sake. I didn't know it was to actually get somewhere. And he said, yeah, he was going to go next month. And you know what? I started to think about it and I got more and more nervous about my dad in Europe. And then I'm driving him to the airport. Now I'm behind the wheel giving him advice. And I'm saying, okay, Dad, okay, bring an umbrella. For some reason, if you get wet over there, you never seem to dry off. And and don't eat the food, any of it. I ate something in Scotland once, and I'll never laugh at the dog for licking the garage floor again. And I said, and learn the language. You've got to learn the language. Like, I've traveled the whole world learning two phrases wherever I go. One is, I'll have another beer, please, and the other is, sorry about the carpet. You can go anywhere on those two phrases. And my dad says, I'm pretty sure they speak English in England. Oh, man, that's what you think. And I was a wreck until my dad got back, and he finally got off the plane, and when I saw him, he had this huge grin on his face, and he gets off the plane, he says, yeah, I haven't had that much fun since Nixon was in office, and he comes out, and we go home, and he's got this stack of photographs. I'd never seen my dad take one picture, let alone a stack of photos called My Trip to Europe, and I looked at the first picture, it was a picture of a cow. I looked at the next picture, it was a picture of a cow, same cow, different angle. Then. Next picture of cow. All of this whole stack was all pictures of a cow. And I said, Dad, these are all pictures of a cow. He says, that's not just any cow, Kev. That kind of cow is where all the cows in America come from. That cow is the great-grandmother of all our cows. And then I realized my dad had gone somewhere. My dad had gone home. The last picture was a woman mowing her lawn. I go, what's this, Dad? He goes, look at that lawnmower. Isn't that the darndest thing? I would have got more pictures, but I ran out of film.
Your folks are from Scotland, like your ancestors are from Scotland and England?
Yeah. My mom's family is from Scotland.
Oh, yeah. My family goes back there, too, my ancestors. And it's amazing. The first time I traveled over there, well, not the first time, but the first time I played outside in England, we had this outdoor festival, and usually with an outdoor festival, I'm looking at like people and just like buildings or something. But this way, while the people are usually looking at me in some beautiful setting behind me. But this time, they had it totally backwards, and I'm looking out at these cliffs over the sea, and it's the ocean, and I'm just staring out at this, and everybody else is looking back at something like me and just nothing behind me. But I was playing the song I've played many times of mine called "Be Here Now," and I came to this part. And it was just this instrumental part in the middle of the song, and my hair totally stood up, and I felt this like jolt go down my backbone, and I felt like, wow, this song was from here, like my ancestors are from here, and I felt like the melody had been written hundreds of years ago, and every choice I had made to, you know, put this melody in my song was made by, you know, hundreds of people going all the way back. And I started thinking about how many people had to get together to make me exist in this world. You know, you think back at how many good dates had to happen to have me happen. It'll blow your mind if you really start thinking about it. So it goes like this. This is the song. I don't know if it was, I felt like there were bagpipes playing it, and so it kind of goes like this. funny how that happens sometimes.
There's a Celtic scholar, John O'Donohue, his name is, and he talks about clay, that if we come from clay, what kind of clay do you come from? A craggy cliff or a peaceful meadow? And he says, our clay determines our characteristic. But more than that, our clay is how you recognize somebody. You're not recognizing somebody, you're recognizing their clay. My mom's clay does come from Scotland, and I was there, and part of my trip took me down into England, and I was missing Thanksgiving with my family. And I thought, I've got to do something to take up the time, because I can't keep thinking of home like this. So I went to a play, it was called The Dresser, with Albert Finney and Tom Courtney. And I went to the play, and I was sitting up in the top with next to this older couple. And during the play, they would sing songs from the 20s and 30s. I remember they sang A Nightingale Sang in Berkeley Square. And when they sang it, everybody joined hands and swayed back and forth and in the whole audience. And the guy next to me, 80-year-old guy, grabbed my hand and went, okay. And I'm so American. And then finally, we got done. And at intermission, I said, were you all in the war? And he said, yeah, he was overseas fighting. And she said she was in the bombing in London. And in the second part, there actually were scenes where bombs fell. And during that, the man reached over and grabbed my hand again. And he would squeeze during the bombings. And then we sang another song. And at the end of the song, he didn't let go. And he held my hand clear to the end of the play.
Be here now, no other place to be, but just sit there dreaming of how life would be if we were somewhere better, somewhere far away from all our worries. Well, here we are, and you are the love of my life. Be here now, no other place to be. All the doubts that linger, just set them free. And let good things happen, let the future come into each moment like a rising sun. You are the love of my life. You are the love of my life. Yeah, you know you are. Sun comes up and we start again. 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 It's all new today. All we have to say is be here now. Now, no other place to be. This whole world keeps changing. Come change with me. Everything that's happened, all that's yet to come, is here inside this moment. It's the only one. You are the love of my life. You are the love of my life. Yeah, you know you are. Sun comes up and we start again. 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 It's all new today. All we have to say is be here now. Hey.
Christmas of my youth puts me at my grandparents' farm. There was a lot of chaos with dogs and cousins, so some rules had to be made. There was one room we couldn't go in. It was my grandfather's office. You could go in there for one reason. At the bottom of his roll-top desks were three books, and we were allowed to choose one of those books. One of them was Curious George Goes to the Hospital, and it was about a monkey who eats a puzzle piece and has to go to a hospital. And that book helped me through many hospital stays as a youth. One of the other books was called The Little Engine Who Could, about a little engine that went over the top of the mountain. And as he went up over the top, he was saying, I think I can, I think I can, I think I can. And when he got over the top, I knew I could, I knew I could, I knew I could. And that book helped me out when I started dating. The third book was called The Mitten, and it was a Ukrainian folktale about a kid who loses his mitten on the way to school. And one at a time, all the animals in the forest crawl into his mitten. You know, first a bug, and then a rabbit, and a fox, and a bear. And I loved it. I was always losing mittens, and I thought, this is great. I wonder if all the mittens I've lost on the way to school are housing forest animals. But it also kind of bothered me because I thought, how could all those animals, how could a fox and a bear fit inside of a mitten? This just doesn't even make any sense. Do Ukrainian children have large hands? I remember we would also have to go to church. You never missed church for anything at my grandparents' house. I mean, if you had a broken leg to get out of church, it had better be compound. And we would go to the Sunday service, and the preacher was interminably long. He was horrible. I mean, the worst one was when he did the begats. He did the entire begats. I mean, it was like having the phone book read right out of the middle of the Bible. And, it was terrible. And I know there's some actors that can make the phone book interesting. Well, he was not one of them. The best part was, at Christmas, they let the youth group do the service. And they would have the youth pastor do the sermon, and he would read out of his modern Bible how Joseph had groovy threads, and Herod was the man, and those that lived by the sword died by the sword, and you knew it was Vietnam. But then, one year, something changed everything. It was the year that the Moog synthesizer and disaster films were invented, the same year, Towering Inferno and Earthquake and Airport. And the youth group took this and ran with it. And they had this Disasters of the Bible. And we all came in, and all these farmers sitting there in these pews waiting for it to begin. And all of a sudden, this low rumbling happened underneath us. What's going on under there? And then a voice over a loudspeaker said, in the beginning, there was paradise. Oh, okay. And we're looking around, and then, but man couldn't leave well enough alone. And God did say, don't make me come down there. And but man did not listen, and God said, then ye shall know my wrath. And now the Moog synthesizer kicks into high gear. And I mean, our ears are starting to bleed as we're taken through biblical disasters of huge proportions. I mean, the towering inferno of Babel. Oh, she's gonna blow. Ah, no. And then walls of Jericho. Ruth, take my hand. I can't. No. And Moses in Egypt, let my people go. No. Then ye shall know my wrath. No. Oh, no. Where have you been, Moses? Traffic. Ah. And then bugs and oh man, it was terrible. And when we got done, everybody, farmers' ears are bleeding. We're all looking up. The cast bows and we applaud. Applause in church. I'll never forget the pastor looking. Applause in church. Christmas was now in the hands of the masses. This is not good. I remember one year my parents decided they were going to host Christmas. We were going to have all our relatives over. And they all started showing up. My aunt, I remember Aunt Betty showing up in her Volkswagen. All these kids piling out like a clown car. And my uncles, oh man, we love my uncles. All my uncles, I mean, we would watch Bambi with my uncles. They're all avid hunters. And by the end, you're like, there's one in the meadow. And Uncle Johnny would pile in. Man, we loved Uncle Johnny. Uncle Johnny had hunting dogs, but he wouldn't hunt with them. No, they're too valuable. And so he never would hunt with his dogs. And every time he'd get a new car, he'd tear the doors off the old one and park it out back, and that became the new dog house. And the dogs would sit in front like they were going somewhere. And Uncle Johnny's favorite thing was to sit in the proscenium of his garage door surrounded by his dogs. I remember one time we're sitting there and Uncle Johnny points to one of his dogs and he says, look at that darn dog, Kev. Been staring at that dead butterfly for 2 hours. 2 hours. And I didn't know I'd been watching it the whole time. Whenever Johnny came over, he needed a task, he needed a job, so he comes in the house, and he's immediately gone into the bathroom for a really long time. And when my dad finally opens the door, he's dismantled the toilet. And my dad says, Johnny, somebody might need that. And Uncle Johnny says, yeah, your wax ring was about to blow. You're lucky you got here when I did. And he says, just go downstairs, get your spare wax ring. My dad says, I don't have a spare wax ring. So Johnny puts on his coat and says, I'll be back in no time. And my dad says, you're not going to find an open hardware store on Christmas. Johnny smiles and he's gone. And I make my way into the kitchen where all my aunts are helping my mom with the potatoes and the gravy. And Aunt Mary is talking why she's worried because she has to tie her husband's hands behind his back 6 times a day to open up his breathing. And she's worried that tying up her husband 6 times a day makes her kinky. And my mom says, not unless you enjoy it, and Mary gets a serious look on her face. And then we all pile into the dining room, and we've made country ham, country ham. It's from Missouri, and it's this way of curing ham where you use salt and sugar and pepper, and you hang it up for months, and then you cut the mold off, and it's this salty meat geode. It's incredible. Oh, man. And you get done eating it, and you know at 3 a.m, you're going to wake up with 2 strong men squeezing your kidneys, and you run downstairs, and you don't even go for a cup. No, you put your head right under the faucet, but you can't. There's 6 cousins' heads in the way just trying to drink. And man, it's that kind of preserving food that we've lost, like kimchi in Korea or sauerkraut in Germany, or lutefisk. It's that way before refrigeration they used to preserve food, but it's, you just love the taste. And my mom has found a country ham, and she sets it down, and everyone gasps like the Cratchits when they set a turkey down at Christmas. And the young kids are going, what is it, what is it, what is it? And we're saying, you're gonna like it. And you know what? They do. It's genetic. They love it. And we finish that beautiful ham, and when we're done, we're about ready to go into the living room. When all of a sudden, Johnny shows up with a wax ring. He says that he went to the hardware store, and there was a guy putting a subfloor in, and Johnny had some rebar in the back of his truck. He traded the guy for a wax ring, and he's holding up the wax ring. We dub it the Christmas miracle. And we pile into the living room, and we sit in front of the Zenith color TV, one of the first color TVs ever invented. You turn it on, and it makes this humming sound, which we now wouldn't know was radiation. And could have cooked that ham right on our laps. And we sit there, and one of the uncles talks about getting an orange for Christmas, and another one says, remember the dog I got? No, that was my dog. And they get in a big argument, and then they pass a baby around, a baby. And this cousin's baby is going around, and I get to hold this baby. I'm a kid myself, and I'm holding this baby, and I'm looking at the baby, and then it becomes clear to me, this is what God sent. God sent a baby. I mean, he tried all those disasters, and those didn't work. So he sent a baby as if to say, be careful. Be careful with your faith. It's fragile. Be careful or it would die. Man, I'm thinking, God is so ahead of us. It's like when my brother looks at a rock and my dad says, don't even think about it. It's like... how does he know? And then... I'm looking at this face of this baby, and as I look in the face, I see my cousin, I see my uncle, I see my aunt, I see my grandparents, my mom and my dad, and as I look in the face of the baby, it makes sense. There are the begets. There are the begets right in this baby. And then I think, we do fit. We all do fit in the mitten.
On the train ride to Paris, or from sunny Barcelona, we rode together down to the docks, and we started laughing. And from out in the open, you called. I don't, these aren't the words. I don't know what I'm singing. I got so into that story. What was I singing? I was so moved, you know? What was I singing, though? That was, it wasn't like I forgot. I was just singing some other song. I was channeling some Scottish song from like, all right, I'm gonna try this again. It took me a long time to, I'm like, these are just completely not the words. I think they might have been rhyming too, which is, I don't know.
All right.
On the train ride to Paris, or from sunny Barcelona, we roll together. No, it's not right. Train ride to Paris. That's not it. On the train ride to Paris, or from sunny Barcelona. As we roll through, it's about, okay, this is what it's about. All right, I'm on a honeymoon with my wife, and we're going from Barcelona to Paris. And we're on one of the sleeper cars, and we could open the window on the sleeper car, and we're rolling through this little town on the Mediterranean, and I was like, this is crazy that people live here, you know? It's unbelievable. And there's this little place where this guy had opened his door, and he was bringing a dinner out to the deck. And we had our window, we just opened our window, and we were rolling through, and all of a sudden we heard these people laughing at their little dinner table, like 5 feet from me, with the Mediterranean behind me. And I was like, that is incredible that people live here. So that's that verse. I don't know how the words go in the verse, but that's the verse. It's weird. I don't even know what that's, okay. I'm never gonna give you up. What do you got if you ain't got love? If you ain't got love, what do you got if you ain't got love? At 9 in the morning, after 9 months of waiting, you were born and I saw your face and you looked up at me. But before I could hold you, the doctors raised you from me. They told me that you might not live, your heart was not healthy. And with wires coming from you, I sat beside you. I'm never gonna give you up. What do you got if you ain't got love? If you ain't got love, what do you got if you ain't got love? Someday soon, you and I will both be gone. Lately I can't help but think that the love we feel will live on. At a little wooden cabin up in northern Minnesota, we ran together down to the dock and you jumped right off it. And from out in the water, you called me to join you. And I said, baby, I cannot swim. If I jump, I'll surely drown you. You said, life has no limit if you're not afraid to get in it. And oh, baby, I jumped to you. Since then, there's nothing I can't do. I'm never gonna give you up. What do you got if you ain't got love? If you ain't got love, what do you got if you ain't got love? Someday soon, you and I will both be gone. Lately I can't help but think that the love we feel will live on.
Mason's one of my favorite storytellers. He gets me all soggy. Last week I was teaching in a grade school, and this girl came up, and what I do when I teach in grade school is I got to tell about my left arm right away. That's how I start them all out, because the kids are all wondering. I got to tell them. I say, okay, I've got 4 fingers on this side, no thumb, so after the show, if you have fun, I can't high five you, but I can high four all day. And this little girl comes up, and I go, high four, and she goes, high two. And she holds up, she has 2 fingers. And I'm talking to her teacher later, and I said, how's she doing in school? She goes, well, let me tell you, last week we were doing turkeys because it's, you know, Thanksgiving. And she said, so we put our hands together and we drew around our hands. And she goes, I got her picture, and there's one turkey with all its feathers and the other turkey with two feathers. So she said, I told her, you know, if you want to, you can use the same hand for both turkeys. So she traced around her hand, and she turned it back in, two turkeys with two feathers. I said, she's going to be fine. And she goes, yeah, she's fine. She's going to be all right. In my time among these constellations, I found there are families I share my blood and families I would give my blood. I found that love thrives in audacity. It dies in carelessness and hides in simple gestures. I found knowledge is acquired, but wisdom is recognized. I've learned anger is a tool, truth has a shelf life, and to kindly rely on the strangeness of others. I've learned when an angel arrives, sometimes it's to wrestle. I've learned there's the trip you plan, and then there's the trip you take. And home has gone from a place that is, to one I remember, to one I now create. Where I know the language unspoken, the names of the gods. It's a place to grieve, to laugh, where I get the jokes, and I will meet you there. I know now when I reach to the stars, some of them, though not burning anymore, will still send their light. I reach at once to the past and to the future. I reach home as the sparks fly into the galaxy.
Oh, my heart is a thoroughbred. I can't sleep in my bed, and everything is burning up inside me. I need something I can feel, cigarettes and a driving wheel. And oh my God, when you cross your legs beside me, I know truth. Sorry signs on cash machines, and it don't look like anything we've dreamed of. I won't let you give it up with sorry sighs and forced bad luck. Come on, baby, let's see what we're made of.
Up to the stars, so I'm reaching to the past. Like my dad, I want to go home. And somewhere between where I sit and the stars send their light, we meet. Me reaching to the heavens and the stars looking down on what it's like to be alive.
I know truth. Anybody else, and all these birds. us here together to remind us that love will rise above it all and just keep growing. Life